Please pray together with me our EWTN family prayer. Today we pray for the priests, brothers, and nuns at EWTN. Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you who have called men and women to follow you and to serve you. We thank you for the priests, brothers, and nuns associated with the work of EWTN. We ask you, Lord, to inspire them, protect them, strengthen them, and guide them. Use them in powerful ways to build up your kingdom and to bring your peace to the world. Let their work enjoy angelic assistance and the help of your grace, so that many may come to know and love you more. Amen.
Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood.
Son of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess
to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I
Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who called the Bishop St. Irenaeus to confirm true doctrine and the peace of the Church, grant, we pray, through his intercession, that being renewed in faith and charity, we may always be intent on fostering unity and concord. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. Beloved, pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord with purity of heart. Avoid foolish and ignorant debates, for you know that they breed quarrels. A slave of the Lord should not quarrel, but should be gentle with everyone, able to teach, tolerant, correcting opponents with kindness. It may be that God will grant them repentance that leads to knowledge of the truth, and that they may return to their senses out of the devil's snare, where they are entrapped by him for his will. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The mouth of the just murmurs wisdom.
The mouth of the just murmurs wisdom.
Trust in the Lord and do good, that you may dwell in the land and be fed in security. Take delight in the Lord, and he will grant you your heart's requests. Commit to the Lord your way. Trust in him, and he will act. He will make justice dawn for you like the light. Bright as the noonday shall be your vindication. The mouth of the just man tells of wisdom, and his tongue utters what is right. The law of his God is in his heart, and his steps do not falter.
Dominus vobiscum. Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Johannem. Jesus raised his eyes to heaven and said, Holy Father, I pray not only for these, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, so that they may all be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. And I have given them the glory you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me. they may be brought to perfection as one, that the world may know that you sent me, and that you love them even as you loved me. Father, they are your gift to me. I wish that where I am, they also may be with me, that they may see my glory that you gave me, because you loved me before the foundation of the world. Righteous Father, the world also does not know you, but I know you, and they know that you sent me. I made known to them your name, and I will make it known, that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. Verbum Domini. Today we celebrate the great feast day of the bishop and martyr Irenaeus, St. Irenaeus of Lyon. He's a much cited theologian today. Vatican II cited him 14 times, second only after St. Augustine. He was born in Smyrna, modern-day Turkey, then was sent to Gaul, France, where he was lived his ministry there in Lyon. And he himself was a disciple of Polycarp, who was a disciple of John. So Irenaeus lived from 135 to 202, so he's very close to the original men that received the gospel, and was close to that time period, the early church. The second century in which Irenaeus lived was threatened by Gnosticism, and this taught that the faith of the church was, as Pope Benedict described it, just symbolism for the simple people who were unable to grasp the true, more difficult concepts, that there was some special secret knowledge necessary for salvation. Dualism also became popular, that there were two gods, an evil god to explain the existence of evil, who made the material world and debased corporal realities, and then a good god. This is, of course, a contradiction to Christian revelation. But if you look at the letters of Irenaeus, he's battling all these different heretics and heresies, and he was the first, really, to develop a systematic theology using scripture and traditions, you know, the teachings of the church, to combat all the errors of his day. You see, like, right from the beginning of the church, there's forces trying to tear at it. You know, maybe today we would see this in a form, this Gnosticism, as a salvation through knowledge alone. You know, no repentance required, that, you know, I just have this secret. I don't have to change my life. I don't have to conform my life to the truth of the gospel. It's just something that I, this interior special knowledge that I have. We see that the tradition of the church is enlivened with the Holy Spirit, and it's made fresh and applied in every age. You know, the teachings, especially manifested in the teachings of the Magisterium, you know, to speak to the errors of the day, to call us to conversion, to point out errors, to come to the true gospel. So Irenaeus was one of the first to do this, to develop a rule of faith, which coincided with the Apostles' Creed. We use this to refute this Gnosticism, that it's the Apostles' Creed was used in his writings to interpret the gospel, you know, to understand what the scriptures mean and to live them, apply them in our life. We see today that Jesus says he's praying for his disciples, and he prays for those that might believe in him through their word, through these apostles that go and preach and their successors. So the ordinary faith, as taught publicly by the church, is the common faith of all. That is the knowledge, the faith, however you want to put it, that's necessary for salvation, what's publicly taught. There's nothing secretly locked away in the Vatican archives that the church is withholding from us. That's necessary for our salvation. That's That's what the church publicly teaches, that we have in scripture and tradition. So this is a temptation always for us, that there's some superior Christianity for intellectuals, you know, that, as I said, that the true gospel and publicly taught is imparted by the successors of those original apostles, the bishops today, especially gathered in ecumenical councils, you know, taught by the magisterium. That is the faith that we need to have in order to be saved. And we see that this rule of faith teaches that the dignity of man is rooted in his body and soul. There's not some dualism of a material evil world and some good spiritual world. See, the temptation is that they would say, these heretics, that, you know, this gospel teaching is spiritual, is special knowledge, and it's made just for the spirit, not for the body. So it doesn't matter what I do in the body. Consequently, you know, you can see in his letters the different heretics just embracing every form of depravity and sin, because it doesn't matter what we do in our body. It's just this secret knowledge. No conversion is really necessary. And one of the most famous quotes of St. Irenaeus that we hear today, and we usually only just hear part of it, it says, "The glory of God is man fully alive." That's usually the part that we hear. But he goes on to say, "And the life of man is the vision of God." If you look in the Catechism where it quotes that, it says, it goes on to even increase, you know, even say more of the quote. It says, "If God's revelation through creation has already obtained life for all the beings that dwell on earth, how much more will the Word's manifestation of the Father obtain life for those who see God?" So we see, we receive this natural life from God's creation. How much more do we see in the revelation of the Word for our supernatural life, eternal life, heavenly life? That, you know, Jesus is praying that we be given the same glory that he was given, this transcendent holiness of God, that through him and in him, we become sons of the Son, sons and daughters of God in Jesus Christ, that we can, as Ephesians 1 talks about, that we're made to be his sons through Jesus Christ in praise of his glorious grace. Jesus, who's incarnate, body and soul, uniting the material and spiritual world, that through baptism and faith, being united in him, we share in his relationship with his Father, his sonship. And this is in praise of his glorious grace, of the Heavenly Father, that it happens by his grace, adopted by his grace to be his children, united to Jesus by grace, having our sins washed away and forgiven through Jesus Christ. So the man fully alive is transformed by Jesus Christ, united in him, who has in him eternal life, the beatific vision. So that's what we're called to. That vision of God, that fullness of life in him. And sometimes we hear that in our modern ears, the glory of God is man fully alive, that, you know, us just out there living life with the pedal to the metal to the full is somehow the fullness of life that God, that's what the modern world interprets it. But it's saying, you know, St. Irenaeus is saying it's through union with Jesus, being transformed in him, coming to know the Heavenly Father, and being united in him. That's what he's praying, that's what Jesus is praying for, that they may be one as we are one, that they be brought to perfection as one. That oneness, that communion, that unity, that being fully alive, you know, yes, living life to the full in the sense of, you know, using our intellect and our will in the sense of being filled with knowledge of Christ, knowing him, having a real relationship with him, loving him, that's being brought to a fullness of life, to a perfection. And that doesn't happen in isolation. If I'm going to be united with Jesus, I am going to be united with my brothers and sisters. So this is a very important teaching of our faith, that we're not saved as isolated individuals. We're saved united in the body of Christ, and that our culture, our society, our common life are to serve this union, that there is a common good, that our government, our economy, our culture should foster, that it reaches its fullness in our faith. We're united with Jesus and brought together as one in Him and offered to our Heavenly Father. But that needs to play out practically in all dimensions of our culture and society. We speak of the social doctrine of the church. We're not radical individuals. And this certainly is a temptation for us in America, I think, to lose sometimes that sight of our common heritage, our common life that we're called to. Christianity serves this common good, serves this unity among nations. I mean, it's found in the preeminent way in the church, and it needs to be played out in the world at large. May we be servants of this unity, of this communion that God calls us to. Let us offer our petitions to the Lord, who looks down on us and knows all our needs, for He gives peace to those who trust in Him.
For the bride of Christ, the church, that we may remain faithful to our baptismal promises, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
that we may always be thankful for God's plentiful gifts, we pray to the Lord. There may be an end to the violence of crime, war, abortion, and oppression. We pray to the Lord. That young people will enjoy the love and harmony that can only come from God. We pray to the Lord. That every believer, fed with the bread of life on earth, may find life in the world to come. We pray to the Lord.
Almighty, ever-living God, we confidently call you Father as well as Lord. Renew your spirit in our hearts. Make us ever more perfectly your children, so that we may enter upon the inheritance you have promised us. We make our prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord, hold our hearts till thou wilt in peace.
sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and for all his holy church.
May the sacrifice we offer you with joy on the heavenly birthday of Saint Irenaeus bring you glory, O Lord, and instill in us the love of the truth, so that we may keep the Church's faith inviolate and her unity secure through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et nunc spiritu.
Sumus concorda. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you are glorified when your saints are praised. Their very sufferings are but wonders of your might. In your mercy you give ardor to their faith, in their endurance you grant firm resolve, and in their struggle the victory is yours, through Christ our Lord. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth, sing a new song in adoration, and we, with all the host of angels, cry out, and without end, we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus.
Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Mysterium fidei.
Mortem tuam annunciamus Domine.
celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Irenaeus, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Robert, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Erit ipsum et cum ipso et in ipso, est ibi Deo Patri omnipotenti, in unitate Spiritu Sancti, omnis honor et gloria, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Recepti salutaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, audemus dicere.
Pater noster, qui in excelsis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, venia regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra.
Quaesimus Domini ab omnibus malis, da proficis pacem in diebus nostris, ut ope misericordiae tue duti, et efficato sim semper liberi, et ab omni perturbatione securi, expectantes beatam spem, et eventum salvatoris nostri, Iesu Christi. Christe crucis de apostolis tuis, pacem aliquo vobis, pacem eando vobis, ne respicias peccata nostra, sed fidem ecclesiae tuae, eamque secundum voluntatum tuam, pacificare et coordinare dignedis, qui vivis et regnas in saecula, saeculorum. Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata nostra,
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Remain in me as I remain in you, says the Lord. Whoever remains in me and I in him bears fruit in plenty.
For those who cannot now receive Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament, we offer the following prayer. O Jesus, thou hast given us in the Holy Eucharist thy body and blood to be our spiritual nourishment, through which we may have life everlasting. Would that I were able to receive thee this day in Holy Communion. I desire with all my heart to receive the living bread which comes down from heaven. O Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst enter under my roof. Say but the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let me taste at least the sweetness of a spiritual communion. Come to me, Jesus, my Lord, my Master. Come and refresh my soul. Strengthen me that in union with thee I may do perfectly the Heavenly Father's will. Let me never be separated from thee by sin. Soul of Jesus, sanctify me. Body of Jesus, save me. Blood of Jesus, wash me. Water out of the side of Jesus, purify me. Passion of Jesus, comfort me. O good Jesus, hear me. Hide me within thy sacred wounds. O Sacred Heart of Jesus, receive me. O Immaculate Heart of Mary, plead for me and love me. Amen.
Sanguine.
us pray. Through these sacred mysteries we pray, O Lord, give us in your compassion an increase of that faith which brought glory to the bishop, Saint Irenaeus, as he maintained it even unto death. And may the same faith bring to us who truly follow it justification in your sight through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Dominus vobis cum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus.
Holy Father, who dwellest in heaven, we are thy children, since thou dost will to be called our Father. May thy name be hallowed, honored, glorified, May thy perfections be praised and exalted more in whom I can believe. May we manifest in ourselves, by our works, the splendor of thy grace. Extend then thy reign. May thy kingdom ever increase, this kingdom which is also that of thy Son, since thou hast made him the head of it. May thy Son be truly the King of our souls, and may we testify to his kingship over us by the perfect accomplishment of thy will. May we, like him, ever seek to adhere to thee by fulfilling thy good pleasure, thy eternal designs for us, so as to be like Jesus in all things, and through him, worthy children of thy love. Amen.
Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God." John chapter 6, verses 68 and 69.
And so is everyone else that out there when they choose to live for God. You see, I'm nothing without God. But what makes me amazing is not what I do, but who I am. Who I am in my baptism. Who I am in my baptism is amazing. I was baptized priest, prophet, and king. And so have many of you been baptized priest, prophet, king. And when we've been baptized priest, prophet, and king, that makes us amazing, amazing, and amazing. What makes my kids amazing, my son. My sons, my daughter, is that they are my kids. And what makes me amazing is that I am a kid to God the Father. So everybody's amazing, even me, and even you.
I am hungry for the love of God to give this soul her food, her Lord in the Eucharist. O Trinity, eternal Trinity, fire, abyss of love, was it necessary that you should give even the Holy Trinity as food for souls? You gave us not only your word through the redemption and in the Eucharist, but you also gave yourself in the fullness of love for your creature.
Joan's Realm. I'm sure you know it's Rome because you know that behind me is the Colosseum. The Colosseum was built between the years 70 and 80, originally known as the Flavian Amphitheater because that was the name of the emperor who had this built. Now, it took 10 years to build, but when it was opened, the opening ceremony lasted 100 days. There were mock naval battles, there were gladiators fighting one another, and so forth. Now, how did the Flavian Amphitheater come to be known as the Colosseum? The Colosseum did not denote the size of this amphitheater. It was the largest in the entire Roman Empire. But the Colosseum, the name Colossus, referred to a colossal statue of the Emperor Nero, which was outside on a piazza adjacent to the Colosseum. The Colosseum originally had four different levels. You can tell the levels today by walking about maybe two-thirds of the Colosseum. Some of the upper level has disappeared over the centuries, mainly due to earthquakes. There were 76 entrances on the ground to get into the Colosseum. And when people came in, they walked up, very much like a modern stadium, they walked up ramps to get to their seats. Your seat level, where you were placed, had to do with how wealthy you were. Women and very poor people were, should we say, exiled to a specific, not really good part of the amphitheater. One of the most outstanding aspects of this Colosseum, of this amphitheater, was the fact that it did have a removable cover that could be brought over the top of the stadium when, for example, the weather was particularly hot or particularly sunny and in inclement weather, and then they could just roll it back. Now, for many years, there were mock naval battles. They would fill the bottom part of the Colosseum with water, but after a while, however, they would drain the water, but so much remained in the land that the Colosseum was actually, the foundation became weakened, and they were on the verge of losing the Colosseum, so they stopped the naval battles. In 1749, Pope Benedict XIV endorsed as official church policy the view that the Colosseum was a sacred site where early Christians had been martyred. He consecrated it to the Passion of Christ, and he installed Stations of the Cross. Although some Christians undoubtedly did die in the Colosseum, there seems to be no historical evidence to support Benedict's claim that large numbers of Christians were martyred here. Now, the Colosseum has been the site of Roman Catholic ceremonies in the 20th and 21st centuries. And especially, and I'm sure many of you will have seen this, every year during Holy Week, the Pope leads the way of the cross on Good Fridays. And interestingly enough, if you just happen to be in the Colosseum at 10:30 on a Sunday and you still have to go to Mass, there is a chapel, there is Mass at 10:30 on Sundays. Venerable Bede wrote in the 8th century, "While the Colosseum stands, Rome stands. When the Colosseum falls, Rome falls. When Rome falls, the world falls." You've seen it 1,000 times in movies. You've probably seen it twice as many times in photographs. But now, you're here. You're in Rome. Come to the Colosseum. For more insights into the daily life here in Rome, check out my daily blog, Joan's Rome, on EWTN.com.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
EWTN, live truth.